In today's lecture, we'll continue with applications of constraint-based modeling, and we'll look at the example of metabolic engineering going away from drug target identification, and we'll look at how lycopene biosynthesis was engineered in E. coli using, you know, information from computational approaches and flux balance analysis. So the next example is, let's switch to metabolic engineering. The lycopene is an important nutraceutical. So it's a carotene that's found in tomatoes and so on and other red fruits. It's used as a food colorant and has antioxidant properties, and it has already been produced using engineered E. coli. And Stephanopoulos and colleagues applied FBA and MoMA to a metabolic model of E. coli to predict targets for improving lycopene production. And they finally came up with a strain that overproduced lycopene by 37% corresponding compared to the parent engineered strain. So the parent strain was already an overproducer, and they could improve upon that by 37% solely using an FBA MoMA approach. So what did they do? This is how the pathway looks. So there's glucose that goes to DHAP, G3P, and then to DXP, finally here to lycopene, right? And the net reaction is something like 8 G3P plus 8 pyruvate plus 16 NADPH plus 8 ATP, producing one lycopene. So this is the reaction. With the engineered strain used by the authors had 3 genes overexpressed. So there's ISP, DXS, and IDI. So these are the 3 genes that were overexpressed. So this is the most common kind of overexpression that one would expect, wherein you just overexpress the pathway genes themselves, all the pathway genes. So this is like the important sub branch that goes towards lycopene. You overexpress all of these. So initially what they did was they tried to maximize lycopene behavior as the objective function. So they set up lycopene production as the objective function and to figure out the phenotype. They found that there is a direct inverse relationship between stoichiometric maximum lycopene yield and growth. So this is not a growth associated metabolite. Higher the growth, lower the lycopene. Lower the growth, higher the lycopene. And they also found a direct relationship between stoichiometric maximum lycopene yield and glucose uptake. So you need to have a trade-off. So you want to reduce the growth yield somewhat and also maintain a high glucose uptake rate for enhanced lycopene production. So the method they did was they tried to knock out every gene to see if it could possibly positively impact lycopene production. So they knocked it out and simulated using FBA and MoMA. So the plot illustrates the effect of single gene deletions. So the y-axis is the in silico fraction of maximum yield, and the x-axis is in silico growth rate. So you see that sometimes growth is very high, sometimes lycopene is here the growth and lycopene are low. So here both growth and lycopene are reasonably high. So GDHA is a good knockout, right? That just talks about some in silico the genome, right? What are all the reactions or something like that. So they had a single knockout scan that predicted 8 genes whose deletion yielded enhanced product synthesis, and these enzymes included ACEE, cytochrome oxidase, glutamate dehydrogenase, glycine hydroxymethyltransferase, and so on. These are the genes that they found quite interesting. Yeah, so see, pyruvate dehydrogenase is probably involved in pyruvate production, which is an important input to this. And so some of these might just be manipulating the redox balance, because if you see there were lots of NADPH involved and so on. So this is the importance of doing a systems level metabolic engineering, because you will be tapping into the whole metabolic network, not just the product forming reactions and so on. So if you look at traditional metabolic engineering, a lot of wisdom is about let's maximize the pathway enzymes and so on. But it turns out that you can identify many sort of non-intuitive reactions by doing a systems level study. They also try to do exhaustive double knockouts, right? You knock out 2 genes at a time, but that's reasonable, because if you have around 1000 genes, you're talking about 500,000 combinations, as we discussed in the previous class about synthetic lethals. But exhaustive multiple knockouts is much harder, right? If you're talking about 1000 choose 3, that's like 1.1617 billion. So what they did was a sort of greedy knockout. So they took the best double knockouts and knocked out one more gene from that. So they took the best double knockout strains and did a single gene deletion on that strain, right? That's only about doing like 1000. So if you take the best 8 or something and do a single gene deletion, you're talking about 8000 LPs to solve. That's not a big deal. And this table is very interesting. So FastSL works well for for getting a lethal phenotype. Here you want a non-lethal phenotype, so the same assumptions won't actually hold that easily. So you'll have to, it's kind of tricky, so we haven't gotten around to that yet. So this table is very interesting, and this kind of summarizes the entire approach. So it tells you that your predicted increase and actual increase may not, will not match, may even vary in direction, but you are very likely to hit a good a good strain by doing this modeling, right. So remember, the model is wrong, but it's quite useful, right. So here what we have are, there are five single knockouts here and four double knockouts and a bunch of triple knockouts. So the growth rate is listed here, the actual growth rate, the predicted growth rate in percent, and the increase in lycopene production, right. So the predicted increase in lycopene was 54%, but in reality you got about 37%, not bad, right. Whereas here you predicted 100% increase and you only got a 4%. So there are going to be these kinds of mistakes, but the bottom line is, if you wanted to try about 10 strategies, you are very likely to get successful in at least one of them, right. So here we have about 10-15 strategies, and one of them was a big winner, right. So this is the bottom line, and basically you had about 6600 ppm of lycopene that was produced by this process. So to summarize, the experimental results sort of followed the trends suggested by the simulation, not the exact quantitative values, although the study was done in 2005, and since then the accuracies have really improved for flux analysis. So you can actually try and fit some fluxes. If you fit some fluxes, you will be in a much better position. If you measure a few fluxes and fit them better, you can already get along with FBA by just measuring the uptake rates and feeding them to the model. It's reasonable enough, but you can do better than that. And this of course emphasizes the potential of metabolic modeling, and you can anticipate better results if you integrate more regulatory information and so on. Without using any regulatory logic, we've been able to get such a reasonable prediction. So the final result was a knockout, a triple knockout that afforded 37% improvement over the parental overproducing engineered strain. I hope today's lecture convinced you that computational approaches such as flux balance analysis are very useful for metabolic engineering, for predicting strategies for metabolic engineering. And in the next video, we will look at an integrated approach that combines various aspects of various systems level aspects to predict what are all the high confidence drug targets in tuberculosis.